Hey everyone, my name is Piyush, and today I'm going to show you how you can host a static website in AWS Cloud using S3 and CloudFront. So I'll walk you through all the different requirements and all the steps that we need to perform, and then we can do the hands-on. So these are the basic bare minimum that we need to set up to host a website. So we need a domain name, we need a DNS service. We need an AWS account, an S3 bucket to host the website, an SSL certificate to make it more secure, and then a CloudFront distribution. So if you are new to AWS service, don't worry about it. I'll try to explain in each and every service that we're going to use, and then we can do the actual hands-on demo. So as I said, first we need a domain to host the website on. So we have a lot of different domain registrars that we could choose from. So we have Route 53, which is AWS domain registrar. Then we have Namecheap.com. We have GoDaddy. We have HostGator. There are like a lot more. So I have purchased a cheap domain at Namecheap.com. So this is my domain over here, the officeguy.xyz. So if we go over here, the officeguy.xyz, you won't see anything because there is nothing hosted. But you'll see that this domain was recently registered at Namecheap. Our first step is completed. Now we have a DNS on which we can host a website. The second step is we need to have a DNS service. So as I said, like we could use a Route 53 service, which is provided by AWS itself, or we could use a free one, which is like what I have used over here is Cloudflare. So the next step is we need to log into our AWS account. So if you already have an account, you could just directly log in using your credentials, or you could go to aws.amazon.com and click over here, create a new AWS account, and it'll be just a quick wizard which will walk you through how you can set up a account, and it'll be free for first 12 months, so don't worry about it. And I already have an account, so I'll just log in with my credentials. And then it'll ask me some more details. Okay, click on submit. Once you log into AWS, it'll present you with the management console that you see over here. There are a lot of services. If you expand this all services tab over here, you'll see a lot of services that Amazon provides. And we'll be first looking into S3. S3 is a storage service, so you could find it under storage over here, or you could just search in the search bar. You see scalable storage in the cloud. So S3 is used for various purposes, and we can upload our files, download our files, share files. We could stream the logs to it, or you could host a static website, which is what we are trying to do over here. You see a lot of different options. And we don't have to worry about it. Just consider S3 as a placeholder of all your files. It is a folder, and it will be presented in a folder type of structure. So if you click on create a bucket, this is a bucket in which all your files will be contained. You can have as many as bucket as you want, and it can scale up to like there is virtually no limit of how many files you could upload it to the bucket. But just make sure like you are only uploading or accessing files that is really needed by you, because it'll then cost you based on the number of file reads and writes and the storage as well. Okay, the bucket name, we'll start with this. The bucket name should be unique across all the AWS users. So you cannot have a bucket name, let's say demo, if it's already been taken by someone else. You will see an error over here. Once I click on create bucket. So I'll use something that is unique for me. And just for the purpose, because we are hosting a static website, we have to make sure that the bucket name is same as our domain name. So which is the officeguy.xyz, that's my domain name. So I have to use the same bucket name. This is the AWS region in which the bucket will host your host all of your files. This is the logical location where your files will be uploaded to and from where it can be accessed. You see a lot of different locations over here. So because I'm in Canada region, so I'm choosing this one, Canada Central. So you can choose whatever location is nearby to you. We have different locations within Asia Pacific, Canada, North America, Europe, etc. So just choose the one that is closest to you and you should be good. Then this is for all the access requirements that there are different options that you can choose from to provide access to your users. So let's say you have to share a file to a particular set of users. So you don't want to be it publicly accessible over the internet for security reasons, because we are hosting a static website over the internet. So that means it has to be publicly accessible to everyone and everywhere in the world. So we have to disable this over here, block all public access, because it has to be publicly accessible. And then we acknowledge that the current setting might result in the bucket and object within become public. So that is what we are trying to do over here. Bucket versioning is when we have to maintain all the versions of files. It can be set at bucket level or at the file level. So we don't want to do that for now. Just keep it default, which is disabled. Tag, we could associate different tags with the bucket for billing purpose, for reporting and running analytics on that. We'll just keep it default for now. And if we go to advanced setting, I'll just keep everything else as default, and we click on create bucket. Okay, so our bucket is created and it's hosted in Canada Central region. Objects can be public. That means even though we have selected it to become public, but it's not public yet unless we attach a bucket policy with it. I'll show you how we can do that. Once we have our bucket ready, the next thing we would like to do is we would upload our code to the bucket. So we go to the bucket over here and you see they have different options. We have objects as the first tab, so we'll upload files over here. So I have my sample website placed over here in some folder, so I'll just upload these three files. Okay, so I'll click on that, and then okay, I'll keep everything as default. And okay, so there is a concept called storage class within S3. Whenever you have a file, it should reside in either of the storage class. Standard class is the one that is default, and it is mainly used for frequently accessed data. So our website would be used frequently. That is what we are hoping for. That's why it should be this one. Then we have intelligent tiering, and then we have standard IA, which is like infrequent access data, and there are a lot more. Over here, which is Glacier and Glacier Deep Archive, this is mainly used for archiving the data, and we will not be using that for this particular demo. And so every storage class has different pricing structure associated with it. I'll walk you through that at the end of this demo. And so basically these are the only options that we would be looking into, and then we click on upload. You see our files are being uploaded over here. Then we click on close and we see all the contents over here. Next thing that we want to do is we want to use these particular files as a static website. So we click on properties. We go down at the bottom and we see an option over here which says static website hosting. We click on edit, and it's by default, it's disabled. So we'll enable it. We choose the first option, which is host a static website. We give a name to the index document, which is our default home page, which is index.html. We give error.html, and then we leave this option blank for now. Click on save changes. Okay, and then you see your website is currently static website hosting is enabled and hosting type is bucket, and you see a website bucket endpoint. So you see the office guy.xyz dot, and it's appended the S3 URL along with it, which is S3 website, and then the region in which my bucket was hosted and dot Amazon AWS.com. if I click on that URL, it says access denied because we haven't configured the bucket policy yet. Okay, so we have to make it public so that anyone can go to the website and access the web page. What we have to do is we go to the console again, go to the objects, and then we go to the permissions. And this particular section we left blank at that time. Now we have to enable the bucket policy to make sure that our users are able to access the website. Click on edit. Okay, then we have two different options to create a bucket policy. First is we have some predefined pre-built examples for us provided by AWS. The next one is we have a policy generator. Let's see the policy generator first. So if we click on that, it will provide you a nice wizard and you just have to input some details and it will create a policy for you. So the first option is select a policy type, which is S3 bucket policy. Effect is allow. Principal would be star because we would basically want everyone to have access to this bucket. And then subservice is S3. And this is the action that we will be providing the access on. So it could be, you know, if a user should have a write access on that bucket or to do certain operations like to delete the bucket or delete the bucket policy. We don't want to do that. We just want our users to have read access to this bucket because it's a static website, right? So we'll have to choose something called get bucket object. So if you scroll down and see get bucket versions, it's get object, and just enable that. And then here we have to provide the Amazon resource name, which is a bucket ARN, which is again unique for a particular bucket. You have to go to your bucket console again, and you see inside bucket ARN, just copy this one and paste it over here. One thing you have to make sure, okay, I'll just first I'll generate the policy. So you see you have, this is the bucket policy that you're gonna generate. Principal is star, that means every principal would have access to that. Allow is the effect, and this is the action that we have specified on this particular resource without any condition. Okay, now click on generate policy, and this particular JSON file will be presented to you. So you copy that and you paste the content over here in bucket policy. The important point to note over here is, so when you specify resource over here, it will just provide you access to this particular bucket, which is, you know, I mean, you don't have the access to bucket contents yet. So for that, what you have to do is you have to add a slash and then star so that you would have access to all the content within this bucket. Okay. And then you click on save changes. Or you could, like, we have just seen the first option, which is policy generator. If you click on policy example, so you'll be presented with different policies pre-built for you, and you could just edit your values to it. Okay, so our policy would be something like this. Okay, granting read-only permission to any anonymous user. So you just copy this and paste it in your bucket policy over here. Okay, so but we have already did that. So let's click on save changes. Okay, so now it says publicly accessible. That means you have not blocked the public access. Also, you have enabled the bucket policy. The next step is you go to your bucket endpoint, S3 endpoint. It will be inside properties and then bucket website endpoint. You copy this one and you open this URL. Now you see you have access to the bucket as an anonymous user. So you could just do this index.html. Oops, sorry, lock was on. So you could do index.html. It will be presented you with the homepage. And then we also have a file which says graphic.jpg. So you have access to all the objects within that particular bucket, right? So this is what we were trying to do. Even though you are able to access the website, but still there is a caveat to it, which is when you, okay, let's say we go to the home page, you see the URL has some extra details that is irrelevant for us, which is S3 website, CA Central, one Amazon AWS.com. So we don't need that. We just need the office guy.xyz. So to do that, what we have to do is we have to create a CNAME within our Cloudflare. For that purpose, what we would do is we go to our Cloudflare, which is over here, and we'll create a CNAME to it. As we were talking earlier about the record set within DNS, there are like mostly we'll be using two types over here for now. One is a A record, another one is a CNAME record. So A record is when you have to redirect a particular domain to a particular IP. For example, like this. So it says the office, whenever a user enters the office guy.xyz, redirect that user to this particular IP. So this is like domain to IP mapping. But when we use CNAME record, CNAME is basically like map a subdomain to another subdomain. For example, if a user goes to www.theofficeguy.xyz, then redirect it to parkingpage.namecheap.com. So if we enter over here, www.theofficeguy.xyz, it will redirect you to a parking page, a default parking page. So this is the logic behind that, why it's happening. So because we have to create these two records, first we have to, you know, delete all like these two records, or we could edit these two, whatever seems visible to you. So what I'll do is I'll click cancel on this and I'll click on this one and I'll paste our S3 bucket endpoint over here. I'll remove this one and also I'll remove HTTP. Then I'll enable DNS only, click on save. This should be good. So all our traffic to www.theofficeguy.xyz will be redirected to this particular bucket endpoint. So that's perfect. So we are able to access our website on our domain, which is the officeguy.xyz. And this is what we have done so far. So this is our, let's suppose this is our AWS cloud. We have user one and user two. So user one requested the website through the web browser, and he entered www.theofficeguy.com. It goes to the DNS service that we have used. It could be Route 53, and in our case, we have used Cloudflare. So it will resolve the IP behind this. It will resolve the service endpoint behind it, and it will authenticate the user because public anonymous access is granted through the bucket policy, and then it will access the file through S3 bucket and give the response to user B. And same way to user B as well. And whatever users are accessing through the website, it has to go through the same route, and the website will be presented to the user. Okay, so this is perfect. We are halfway there. Let's see what we have to do next. So even though you are able to access your website at this particular domain, but you still see the connection as not secured. It's because we have not installed any SSL certificates on this website, right? So if you click on this, it will say your web connection to this site is not secure. So probably what we have to do is we have to install some SSL certificate. And for that very purpose, we'll be using another AWS service, which is called CloudFront. So again, you go to your home page. Okay, either you click on all services and you see over here, or you could just, you know, search over here, CloudFront. So I'll give you a quick overview what CloudFront is. So CloudFront is a content delivery network. So, okay, let me just go to the AWS website and just quickly explain you how it'll work. CloudFront caches all the static contents from S3 bucket or any other service at various edge locations and deliver the same to users from its nearby edge location. Let's say a user wants to access a website, a user from North America region access a website which is hosted in Mumbai region, which is in Asia Pacific, And it has to go, like when he requests the content of the website, it has to travel all the way through the network, and it will result in a high latency response from the website. Website will take time to load, and then the access time would be really high, not resulting in a good user experience. And sometimes the connection will drop off in between. There'll be a lot of issues. So what S3 will do is, what CloudFront will do, it has various edge location. If you see the blue circles over all over the map, so these are all the edge locations that it provides. So if you're, even if your bucket is hosted over here, still your frequently accessed static content will be cached at various edge locations. So when the user is requesting the website first time, okay, from here, it still has to go through that bucket to get the data. But all the other users after that will still be able to access that website from the nearby edge locations. So this is why we are using CloudFront. And then we can install SSL certificate on top of that to make the website secure. And
the next step is we have to create an SSL certificate, which we need to install it to the CloudFront distribution that we have created to make our connection secure and encrypted. Okay. So we have to go to ACM. So this is a certificate manager provided by AWS. Go over there. Okay. Important thing to remember is because CloudFront only support the ACM through one particular region, so we have to change our region from Canada Central to US East 1. As CloudFront will only support this particular region for ACM, so make sure you create your certificate in this region, even if you are using any other region for all of your other services. Okay, so I have changed the region to US East, and then I'll go to get started, request a public certificate. So if you are using a public certificate, this is free of cost, and click on this. Now here you have to enter your domain names through which you want to refer your website. So I'll put in www.bisky.xyz. That's my domain, and I'll add one more name to this certificate. I'll just remove the www. So this, I'll click on next. Okay, these are the methods that we could use to validate our DNS. So I'll choose this one, DNS validation, which is the default method. Okay, I'll leave this as default, review, and click confirm and request. Okay, so now that we have created a certificate, we still have to verify, we still have to confirm that we own these domains. So what we have to do is, it by default, it would have created, because I've used two different domains, so it would have created two different CNAME records. So I have to update these two records in my CloudFront, sorry, in my Cloudflare, okay, where my DNS service is. So I'll just copy this one first. I'll go to the CloudFront, click on add record, create a CNAME record. Okay. And I'll paste it over here. Okay. So my first one was, where it is. Okay. So my first one was this one, which is www. Okay. I'll copy this one as well, paste it over here. There are few things that we need to make sure we are doing it the correct way. So because this is for www, we have to remove every other thing other than www. Okay. So this is how it would look like after this. Okay. And we have to remove the extra dot from the end. And we'll click the proxy status as DNS only. Okay. I'll click on save. So our first record is created. Now I'll go to the second record, copy, and then I'll create a CNAME record again. Okay, in this as well, I have to remove my domain. Okay, and then okay, I'll remove the extra dot. I'll change the proxy status to DNS only. and click on save. So now that we have added both the CNAMEs over here, so AWS will validate it, and once the validation is successful, this will be shown as success. So I'll give it probably 10-15 minutes. I'll pause the video till then, and then we'll come back to see. Okay, so my certificates are now validated. So it's showing status as successful. That means it is now ready to be used. So I'll click continue. Okay, I can see the details from here. Okay, so now what I have to do is I have to create a CloudFront distribution. So I'll change my region back to CA Central 1. I'll go to services and I'll choose CloudFront. Okay, over here I'll go to create distribution. Get started. Okay. So here I have to put my origin domain name. So it'll be my S3 bucket. So if I click over here, it'll be there in the drop down. I'll just have to select it. Origin path, let's keep it blank. Origin ID will be auto-populated. Then we have to make sure that whoever is accessing the website, it has to go through CloudFront and no direct access to the bucket should be provided. So for that, what I'll do is I'll click on restrict bucket access to yes, and I'll create a new identity. So this identity will be auto created, which would update the bucket policy as well. So I have to click over here, update the bucket policy. What it will do is it'll add one more rule to the bucket policy that allow access from CloudFront distribution, this particular distribution and this particular origin. Okay, so I'll keep update the bucket policy as well. And then I need to make sure that even if the user is entering HTTP, even if the user is using the HTTP protocol, it should auto redirect the user to HTTPS. I have clicked on that. Okay, and these are the default fees. Let's keep it like that. And okay, over here we have to enter our alternate domain names. So we have two domain. One is www.fizzguide.xyz separated by comma. I'll put the naked domain name as well. Is fizzguide .xyz without www. Okay, it's done. Now I need to select my SSL certificate that I've created. So if your certificate has not been validated yet, or if you have not created the certificate in US East 1 region, then this area over here, it will be grayed out and you won't be able to select it. Okay, so just make sure that you have certificate provisioned and created in the right region and it's been validated successfully. Okay, so because I have, it's like for me, it's already there. So I just have to click over here and it'll show it in the drop down. So this is the certificate that is there. Okay, these all are the default field. This is again really important. Make sure you add your root object name over here. So for me, it's index.html. So I have to put it over here. If I leave it blank, sometimes website doesn't work. So I'll just put it over here and I click on create distribution. So if you have entered everything correctly, everything is there. It will take like 10-15 minutes and it will be deployed in status. Okay. So I'll pause the video again for another 15 minutes and we'll come back. It took another 5 minutes or so and my CloudFront distribution is now in deployed status, so it's ready to be used. So if I take this domain name from here, this is where my website will be accessible for now. Okay, so I'll click over here, I'll paste it, and it will show you the website's homepage. But now, like we did earlier with the S3 bucket as well, we have to redirect it to our domain name. I'll just go to my Cloudflare. And I'll create two DNS records, which is a type CNAME record, obviously. And then we'll use @ for the root. And I'll paste the distribution domain that we have acquired. Okay, I'll click over here. click on save. Okay. Then I'll create one more CNAME record for my www domain with target as the same. Okay. So now when I go to the officeguy.xyz, I can see my website. And if you see over here a little lock button, which means this is the traffic is encrypted and HTTPS is enabled, certificate is valid, which is what we were trying to do. Okay, and if we do www.theofficeguy.xyz, it's showing the same results, encrypted traffic with HTTPS enabled. This is what we were trying to achieve, and we were able to do it. Now that we have created all the infrastructure pieces and done with all the configuration, our website is finally accessible with an encrypted HTTPS enabled. Let's go and see how does it look like with the diagram. Okay, so earlier we were able to, like, the user was here in one region, another user was here, and they were able to access the website through the DNS service and directly to the S3 bucket. Now we have added one more component in between the DNS and S3 bucket, which is a CloudFront distribution. So what would happen is when a user requests a website, it'll go to the DNS, it'll resolve the URL back to the user web browser, and then the request will be then redirected to CloudFront distribution. It will then get the contents from the bucket, and the response will be provided back to the user. So this is when the user, let's say this user was in North America region. So when the user got the response back from the website, it will be then cached at the nearest edge location over here. So when another user from the same region would try to access the website or try to access the same content or the web page, it doesn't have to, that user don't have to go through all the network route, and it will just get the website from the nearest edge location. This will be way faster than it was for the first user, and all the other users will be able to access the file through the edge locations till the time it's been cached. So the time we can set in CloudFront, and for now, like, it will be cached for the default time, which is 24 hours, and the same way for the other region users as well. So we have completed this one. Now let's see how much are we gonna spend if we follow this model. So these are the different components that we need, that we have created and used. First is an AWS account, which is like free for 12 months, and rest, you can go to the AWS website and look at the pricing. For DNS service, we are, because this is just for the demo purpose and we don't need a lot of features, so we are just using a free account. So this is also free. CloudFront distribution, it is free for 12 months, and then let's look at the pricing after that. So if you go to this particular URL, amazon.com/cloudfront/pricing, you will see the pricing structure. So as I told you, it will be free for first 12 months with a limit of 50 GB of data transfer out, and then 2 million HTTP or HTTPS request. These are like per month. So 2 million requests per month, that is what we are getting with this free subscription. Okay, and after that, after 1 year, this will be on demand based on the number of requests that we are making and based on the data transfer. So this would be, if we scroll down a bit, so this is like based on different region. If we are just using United States, Mexico and Canada region, this would be this much for first 10 TB. And this is just for the data transfer out pricing. And then we have HTTP and HTTPS method pricing. So that would be this one. So you could just calculate based on your traffic and the projected traffic, and you'll get to know the pricing. It won't be much, but from here you can find it out. Okay, the next is S3 bucket. So again, S3 bucket, if you want to know the pricing, you just replace this with S3 and it will redirect you to the page where you could see the pricing. Okay, because we are using S3 standard as the storage class and our bucket is there in Canada Central region, so this would be applicable to us. first 10 TB per month would be 25 cents per GB and so on. So yeah, so this would be, this is for frequently accessed data, which is S3 standard, okay, that we have already discussed. And what else? Oh yeah, so it has like different costs. So this is just for the storage. So our storage would be less than, like I said, if it's gonna be a static website, I don't think it will go beyond 1 GB. So we'll be under this threshold. Then we have charges for request and data retrieval. So for S3 standard per 1,000 request, this would be the price. Okay. Then we have data transfer. So data transfer is like inbound data is free, and data transfer outbound from S3 to internet would be like, it's pretty cheap. Okay. And then we have some other as well. Let's go to the next one, which is SSL certificate, because we are using AWS ACM. It's free of cost, so don't have to worry about that as well. If you have followed me till now, so your website would probably be working and everything is working as expected. But if you are facing any issues, so I'll help you with some of the troubleshooting that would be helpful for you. Okay, so let's go to each of the services one by one. Let's go to the S3 bucket first. Okay. First thing to remember is just make sure your bucket name is same as your domain name. Okay. So because this is my domain name, I have used the same name as the bucket name. Good. Then you should have the public access to the bucket so that it's accessible over the internet. Okay. Now we click on the bucket and we go to the properties. Scroll down, you see your bucket website endpoint over here. Okay. Then you go to the permissions. Okay. You see the bucket policy over here. Earlier, when we created the policy, we created only this part. But then when we created the CloudFront distribution, it appended this policy along with it. Okay. This is because, I've created maybe two distributions, that's why it's showing as two different identities. And we could remove this policy if you want, like if you don't want your S3 bucket to be accessible and only accessible through the CloudFront distribution. So we could delete the first part of it. Okay. That's good. Okay, so everything's good with the S3 bucket. Let's go to CloudFront now. So let's say the recently visited, we go to CloudFront. So we have to make sure our CloudFront distribution was created correctly. So I'll click on over here, the distribution settings. Okay. Make sure you have this in place, default root object. Okay. Which is index.html. It could be index.php or whatever is there, whatever root object is there for your static website. Make sure you have the SSL certificate over here. So if while creating the distribution, your certificate was grayed out or it was not able to be selected, make sure your certificate was created in the correct region, which is North Virginia, and it should be validated successfully before you could use it. Okay. Then the next thing to remember is make sure you have all your alternate domains, CNAMEs over here. So if any of the things are not correct, you could just edit it and make the changes over here on the fly. Okay. Then if you go to the origin group, this would be your origin identity, which was created while we created the distribution. Okay. This is fine. And okay, so if your HTTP requests are not redirected to HTTPS, then make sure you have this behavior in place. This is also what we created when we created the distribution. So if you are using a static website and if you are making changes to it frequently and you see the changes are not getting reflected instantly, it's because CloudFront caches the site at the local edge location for 24 hours by default. So if you want to see your content instantly, so what you can do is you go to this tab, invalidation, and create invalidation over here. You put your static images over here or just do this one for the complete website. and click on invalidate. Once it is successful, then you'll see the latest releases that you have deployed recently. So till now we have verified both our S3 and CloudFront distribution configuration and everything is correct. Now let's go to our DNS page and see if we have all the controls in place. So you should have two CNAME records for your with the target as your CloudFront distribution. Okay. You also should have two CNAME records for your certificates. So this should, if you see the target, it should end with ACM validation certificate, validation.aws, something like that. Okay. So these four CNAME should be there. And you should be good to go. I don't think you should have any other issues while accessing the website or while making updates to it. But if you do, feel free to leave in the comment section and I'll be more than happy to help you out. Please like, share, and subscribe the channel. Thank you very much. You have a good day.